Good morning, everyone. Okay, so I get to start off with our announcements this morning. So if you will look at the seat back in front of you, we have a connect card. If you're new or you have new information, you can fill this out so that we can connect with you. We are also doing Easter lilies. You can go see Mary Beth Durham for those for $15. Just need to have that order in by the end of the month. You can do that like in memory of a loved one who has passed, or those who are still with us, just to honor them. And those are going to be absolutely beautiful because all the flowers Mary Beth does are always gorgeous. So we also have our care cards. Same thing as the connect card in the seat back in front of you. These are for prayer requests, and our prayer team has been praying over those at weekly prayer. And Dad told me this morning that we've already had two that have come back. That we've gotten a follow-up on that was like an answered prayer, which is really cool. So that's what's so good about writing it down, is because then you can come back to it and be reminded of, oh, cool, yeah, that, wow, that really did come to pass. That's awesome. So also in the same vein, we're having prayer every Thursday at noon, and that's been really good, been getting more and more people every week. So anyway, I'll turn it over to Derek to get us started with our worship this morning.
Welcome, everybody. Good morning. We're about to sing about the amazing grace of God. And how many thankful for God's grace today? How many has God's grace saved you from a few things in life? So grace, and there's a difference between mercy and grace, but mercy is not getting what you deserve. You know, I deserve death for my sin. So mercy's not getting what I do deserve, but God takes it a step higher, and grace gives you what you don't deserve. And grace is defined as the unmerited or the undeserved favor of God. And so for no reason other than the fact that God loves you, you have grace today. You have access to grace, the unmerited, the undeserved. How many deserve it today? No one deserves it today. It's the undeserved, unmerited favor of God, and it's amazing. And we're going to sing about that amazing grace this morning. So if you know these songs, you can stand with us and sing with us and just worship with us, and we ultimately just want to lift the Lord up today. So sing with us as we sing.
Amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, which leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Breaks our chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy of this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
If anyone's received God's amazing grace, why don't you give him some love this morning, some praise today. Lord, we love you, Jesus. We thank you for your goodness and your mercy today. We're going to prepare to take up our offering this morning. There's a couple ways to give online. You can give on Cash App. I discovered that the week before last, and it is by far the easiest way to give for me. If you'd like to give, anybody, who carries cash anymore? Anybody carry cash? Hardly ever. So Cash App is an easy app to download and pay. And then there's also PayPal as well. But we're going to pass the buckets for your convenience this morning if you would like to give by cash or check. But Lord, we love you today and we thank you for the opportunity, Lord, that we have to give into what you're doing, God. And Lord, it's not ours to begin with. Lord, you blessed us with it. And Lord, we have the opportunity to give it back to you. And we thank you for that opportunity. And we take advantage of that opportunity because
You bless those that bless what you're doing. You bless those that bless your kingdom. And Lord, today we give into the kingdom of God, and we thank you for it, Lord, for that ability. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated.
Already. Clap your hands to him. Come on. Come on now. Sorry. Kids, y'all can be dismissed. You can be seated. One of the songs we sang before I do that, I want to remind you of our Annie Armstrong Easter offering. We'll be taking that up on Easter, so you should have stuff in your seat back. Missions, North American missions. I'll remind you of that, please. One of the songs we sang was, "We Make Space, We Make Room for You." We need to, on purpose, make room for the Spirit of the Lord to move in our lives, to have space, to have time for Him to move in our hearts and in our lives. What does that look like? Well, it looks different. Fun fact, it looks different most every time He comes. Because about the time you think you got Him figured out and you write a book about it, He resets the key for the map. Because He wants you to ask Him, not read a book. He already wrote a bestseller. Well, blue means this when you dream. Yeah, it does in that one. But it doesn't in this one, because He wants it to mean something else, because He wants you to ask Him. Often my wife dreams more than I do. Mostly she dreams about a better husband, but anyway. she dreams, and we'll talk about it afterwards. She said, "What do you think this means?" I said, "I'm not sure. Why don't you ask Holy Spirit? He's the one that gave you the dream." And I don't mean it's smart. It sounds like I'm being smart, but I said, "You know what? He gave that to you, so He wants you to lean into Him." So I was thinking about that, and we're singing "Let It Rain" here at the end, and what does the service look like? We talked about this Wednesday night, but I watched the chapel service for Asbury. Watched the service that he preached, and then the Spirit of the Lord broke out, and all this happened. I watched it, and after about 10 minutes, I turned it off. It was terrible. I mean that kindly. I'm meaning it from the standpoint of it wasn't Jonathan Edwards, or it wasn't Billy Graham, or it wasn't one of these heroes that was just what we would call shelling the corn. I mean, he was just laying it down. He actually 2 weeks later, he told in chapel he said, "I actually sat down and sent a text to my wife and said, 'Man, I bombed that one. Be home in a minute.'" 30 minutes later, he sent her another text: "Hey, something's going on. Kids won't leave." Hour later, he sent a text to his friend: "Hey, can't make that coffee. Going to have to reschedule." What does it look like when? What is the setup for Holy Spirit to move? Tell a story on a pastor in Houston that I knew. His son-in-law was an evangelist and traveling the world evangelizing. This particular Wednesday night, he came in. Pastor preached. Taught Bible study, dry, wasn't much going on. They got done. They was going to do something else. Somebody else went to the pulpit. He went and sat down, and his son-in-law leaned over and he said, "Hey, Pops." That was a good word. They just didn't understand. Pastor turned and looked at him. He said, "Cancel your Sunday meeting. I don't care where you are. Cancel it." He goes, "What are you talking about, Pops?" He said, "I'm going to show you Sunday what God did tonight. There are no throwaway services." Sunday morning, they had like 15 people get saved and had 5 baptisms. It was crazy what was happening. He said, "But what we were doing is we were laying the foundation, laying the groundwork. What does a Sunday look like when the presence of the Lord moves in and starts radically changing lives? What does it look like 2 minutes before that?" We make space. For an hour, hour and 10 minutes, God, whatever you want to do. After that, we'll negotiate the time frame with God. Just kidding. So, words for worship. We're doing our third week of words for worship. I'm introducing a new word to us this week. It's called Shabbat. If you were Hebrew, you would have to say it with a little bit of a phlegm in your voice. Shabbat. You have to be like you're trying to cough something up. Shabbat means to address in a loud tone, to shout, to commend, to glory, to praise, to triumph, adulate, which means to adore, laud, or soothe. So I'm going to focus on those two aspects of Shabbat. One, loud tone, which is a shout, but also the soothing side of it. That might seem a little bit of contradictory to some of you from the standpoint of that a word for praise could mean loud and soothing. I've heard babies scream, and it was loud. But it was not soothing. L-O-U-D, just kidding. S-H-A-B-A-C-H, Shabbat. Sure. So, since our word today is Shabbat and it means a loud shout, let's practice that this morning. Scream real loud. 1, 2, 3. Sit. That's what I'm talking about. Psalm 63:3-5. Thank you. Y'all didn't think we could do that in this place, but that's okay. I had a few friends. Psalm 63:3. Because your loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall Shabbat you. My lips will praise you, okay? Thus I will bless you while I live. I will lift up my hands in your name. My soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise you with joyful lips. And somebody say amen.
Amen.
So we have Shabbat because God, your loving kindness is better than life. I will Shabbat you. I will shout to you. I will praise you. I will adore you. I will laud you because your loving kindness is better than life. And we're going to learn today that the roar of praise is soothing for your soul. I feel like preaching. So, my title this morning is, What Is It Good For? And some of you are already singing a song. And you've already answered the question. Absolutely nothing. And that is not true. That is not true in this instance. It's actually just the opposite. So I'm not going to read. I've got a bunch of verses here. A whole Psalm 145. I want to give you just a couple verses. I will extol you, my God, O King. I will bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you. I will praise. Halal. We haven't done that one yet. Halal. Your name forever and ever. Halal is dance. Yeah, we'll get there. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall shabak your works to another. Now, let's pause right there for a minute. Ladies, there's a ladies' meeting. What is the word we would like to use there? Conference? Okay. On the day before Mother's Day, and it's called Generations. So, the scripture that Dana has chosen for that is, one generation shall praise your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. And so, that is, Brooke Lee even said this a year or more ago to her mom and I, that she said, you've got a lot of people in your building that have some gray hair, and some of them think they've done their stuff. It's over. They have nothing left to offer, and it is totally 100% false. They have so much in there that they can offer to the younger generation and even to another below that they can help them and teach them. That's the whole purpose, is honoring those generations, but also of being able to get you to give to that generation underneath. Amen. So, skip down to, I don't even know where it is. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works. All your works shall praise you, which is yada. Okay? O Lord, and your saints shall bless you. Then let's go all the way to the very end. The Lord preserve all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth shall speak the praise of the Lord. This is what we're going to get in another week or two. We'll see. It's Tehillah. And all flesh shall bless his holy name. So what is it good for? What is a loud tone or a shout even good for? Well, I made up a list here real quick. You can shout to get someone's attention. You can warn somebody. It's a celebration. It can be a fear when you're afraid, or a laughter, and then even a battle cry. So, I read this, 90% of marriage is just shouting what from different rooms. What? What? that's too funny. I also read there's something called primal therapy, okay? So primal therapy is, as a disclaimer, I'm not a doctor. Okay, I'm not a scientist, I'm not a therapist, I just read stuff and I study, and sometimes I'm still wrong, so don't go mortgage your house on primal therapy. I'm just going to tell you what it means, and then you apply it to your life, okay? Discovered in the 50s, and it was originally thought to help people deal with deep trauma. The idea was you're screaming out because of emotional issues, and these deep seated emotional traumas or issues in your life. More recently, it's been studied that found that the yelling itself doesn't actually help you, but it's actually seen to be like a starting place. And because when you have deep emotional trauma and you yell, then sometimes it's like, that's actually in there. Oh, okay. And so then it actually gives you a starting place, a place to open up that you can get help with therapy or counseling or the Spirit of the Lord, you know, whatever. So if you're feeling that, it may be just give a good yell and go see a therapist. So I also learned that as we kind of get this out of the way, let me just help you for a moment on this. Yelling is not good for you or for someone else if you're yelling at them. Now, most of the time, my parents watch our service. So y'all can all turn into the screen and turn to the cameras and say hello. But this is just facts. We were raised as yellers, okay? That's what we did. That's what we do. It's what we did. We were yellers. And so when Dana and I got married, I made up my mind that I wasn't going to yell. I wasn't going to yell at her. And I wasn't going to yell at the kids. And I haven't done that. We've been married in April 29 years. I haven't yelled at her. I haven't yelled at the kids. Period. You know why? Because I'm a professional. I get paid to yell. I will win. And I didn't think that was fair. I'm trained in the arts of yelling. I have a degree on my wall that says I get to yell. It's not on my wall. Don't make fun. It's sitting on the floor in my attic because I haven't moved into the office yet. So if you're shouting at someone, the psychological effects of that on the brain are stress, anxiety, and even depression. Okay. So we're going to do this. Everybody close your eyes. If you're a yeller or in a family of yellers, lift your hand. Okay, put them down. Okay, everybody open your eyes. The purpose of shouting or yelling at someone is usually to control another person's behavior. And it causes stress, behavior problems, low self-esteem, and the list goes on. So what I've learned is that you need to avoid yelling at other people. Many have yelled at your kids too much. Maybe you've been a yeller, so maybe let me just give you a couple things to help you. If you're prone to yelling at others, number one, try to listen more than you talk. Two, practice empathy for the person. Three, speak slower and softer than you usually would. This is one of the things I tell my brother. My brother was here once. He's 6'5". He's a grown man, okay? And his daughter, she's gained a little height now. She's taller, but, you know, she used to be a baby. That's the way they come out. And she would go to at 5 or at 6 or at 10, she'd come and say something to him. And I would say, Bart, if you're having a serious conversation with her, you need to sit down. And you need to look up. And you need to take the bass out of your voice. That's a good word right there. I said, you don't need to be doing this, talking to her, lowering the bass and you're putting the bass back in your voice. No, you need to, hey, baby, I'm sorry. What do you need? On purpose. And then even say it softer than you would. Hey, I'm sorry. What, baby? Posturing yourself in not an overbearing way. So, 4, make your expectations clear so you don't have to yell them. And 5, ask for help when you feel overwhelmed. Here's another fun fact. If you yell, you'll have to yell. Because they don't think you're serious until you do. Okay, I've never been in the military. I didn't even play a part in a TV show on a military. But I've never done that. But I just have this crazy feeling that if those drill instructors would just tell you to do what you want done, it would get done. But they yell because they have other things they're trying to do. They're trying to make you depressed. They're trying to make you anxious. They're trying to make you stressed. They're trying to make you broken down and break you down so that you will be, yeah. Your family's not your squadron, okay? You don't need to be yelled at. Tell them what you want. Issue the ramifications that need to happen afterwards if they don't do it. To this day, when I yell to Benj, slacked up just a little bit. He had his birthday. He had a 23rd birthday this week. So it slacked up a little bit in the last couple of years, which is cool. I mean, he's an adult. But till he was 20 years old, when I said his name from the bottom of the stairs, he would stand up from whatever he was doing and he would come to the top of the stairs and say, "Yes, sir." When I yell, "Come to me," because I'm not yelling at you, I'm yelling to you. I'm trying to get your attention. Hey, I need you. Benj. Get up. He'd come. What's up, Dad? Hey, I need to do it. Okay, cool. Can I do it now or later? Okay. So, if you're coping with being yelled at, let me give you a couple things to help you cope. Take care of your body. Get enough sleep. Find ways to be active. 2, practice mindfulness and relaxation exercises. 3, find supportive people to talk to about how mean your parents are. And get help that you need if you're in a dangerous situation. Find help. Get out. Okay? Listen, if you're being yelled at and it just keeps up, you need help. And the person that's yelling needs help. I'm being serious. There's no way. You don't have to live that way. They don't have to live that way. There's something else going on inside of them. They don't have to live that way. They need healing. That's a good word. Some of you are scared to say amen because the person next to you is going to yell at you. Don't do that. Just kidding. So here's another fun one. So some of you have been to the gym or you've seen guys that were trying to lift heavy weights or girls trying to lift heavy weights. I practice not doing this. I don't do this on purpose. But there are guys that when I had a friend that was in Lexington that we lifted together, and he liked to yell out primal yells when he would be lifting, and he lifts some pretty heavy weights too, and it was funny to watch him, and it was funny to listen to him, and it was funny to spot him and be a part of what he was doing because it was just fun. But when they're lifting and they're grunting and they're Dana always comes on, "Why y'all got grunt when you lifting weights and stuff? Furthermore, when you set them down, why you got to look in the mirror and see what's going on, you know? What's going on?" So it is about, I do make noise. Some guys, the funny ones are the ones that have headphones on and they don't know the noise they're making. Because some of these really, really big, muscular guys actually sound like girls when they're grunting and they're lifting weights because they can't hear themselves. It's really messed up. I'm not even going to imitate it. But, you know, there are times that I'll make noise just from lifting, but it's because I'm breathing out. You got to breathe in, and then when you push it up, you got to breathe out. I'll grunt, something like that, but I won't do one of those. There's some of them that will just do those big, loud ones, you know. I was going to do that this morning, but I decided not to. Talk myself out of it. What about baseball or even tennis? If Monica Seles was the worst at this, of making a grunt every time she would swing the racket. Oh, 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 every single time. Then what about the boxers that are going to, or the karate guys that are going to kia every time they go to punch, you know, and stuff. There's something to letting your voice out when you are exercising, when you are exerting yourself. Luke chapter 17, verse number 11. "Now it happened as he went to Jerusalem and he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Then as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers who stood afar off, and they lifted up their voices and shouted." They lifted their voices. They didn't said. They shouted. They lifted their voices and said, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." So when he saw them, he said to them, "Go show yourself to the priest." And so it was that they went and they were cleansed. As they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw he was healed, returned and with a loud voice glorified and fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. So Jesus answered and said, "Were there not 10 that were cleansed? Where are the 9? Were there not any found who returned to give glory to God except this foreigner?" And he said to him, "Arise, go your way. Your faith has made you whole." This is an interesting text to me because these 10 lepers, they lifted up their voice. So all 10 of these men were lifting up their voice. "God, have mercy on me. God, heal me. God, help me." And then Jesus says, "Go show yourself to the priest," which meant they had to take a step of faith. Because to even go near the priest, they had to be cleansed. So for them, they started going. And as it says, as they went, they were healed. So as they were walking away from Jesus to the priest, they were healed. And they were made whole. But this shows that the nine of them just kept going. And one realized he was healed and ran back to Jesus. And with a loud voice, gave glory to God. I got a point this morning that I want to make, and I don't even have time to preach it, but I want to say this. Don't let your prayer be louder than your praise. Mama, in the midnight, when the baby's sick, we can cry real loud. But when the baby gets better, don't whisper a thanks. Hello? I mean, folks, that's what they did. They screamed until he healed them, and then they forgot about him. The problem is what they asked to be healed from, they didn't get whole from until they praised. I told you I didn't have time to do this, but I'm going to take us just a minute here. Look, so when we're asking for something, we don't even know what we need, and a lot of times we ask the wrong stuff. Hey, take this leprosy away. Perfect. But you still don't have any fingers. And the one that began to worship was made whole. Oh, he'll heal you and stop the downward spiral. But what if it's the fact that we've got to turn that back to worship for him to actually come in and fix it all? So just imagine for a moment, if you go to a concert, everybody's singing all the same songs, and even the guitar player or the singer, he'll just stop singing for a minute, and the whole crowd is singing the songs, you know, singing the... I was going to sing one, but I'm not. Singing, and it's fun, and it's a celebration, and everybody's enjoying, everybody jumping and bumping each other. Yeah, that's my song, that's my jam, you know, going on. I'm always teasing the coaches when we come out to a coaches meeting in basketball, and they got some crazy, you can't even understand the words, and it's so loud, and it's blaring over the speakers, and we can barely talk, have a conversation, and get them to tell them, we don't want you to fight each other, we just want you to play basketball. And we tell the coach, and this is a fun one, I said, coach, coaching box is clearly marked. We don't really care if you're in the coaching box or not, as long as you're not fussing at me. I'd prefer you not fuss at me, you just talk to me. But if you want to fuss, I need you to stop for a moment and have a moment of clarity and look down and see where you're standing, because if you're not standing in that box, this is your warning. You will not get a warning. If you're yelling at me and you're standing out of the box, you're going to get a technical. Cool? Good. So, guys, you got any questions? I mean, that's what I say to them in the pregame. And most of the time I say, is this your playlist? This is pretty good. Yeah, I've never heard it before in my life. What in the world is this stuff you're playing? Softball's worse. Softball plays some really crazy stuff. The songs they sing that they're playing over the... I'm like, what is this? What exactly are you dropping like it's hot? Think for a minute, though. What happens in a concert when everybody's got it all going, we're all singing together, we're all cheering together, we're all clapping together, jumping, doing that. It's something that's released in our brain that's called oxytocin. And it's a feel-good hormone. Some call it the love hormone. So imagine, if you will, that concert. Imagine taking that into a church service and beginning to worship together. What is released? When we're clapping together, when we're singing together, when we're laughing together, when we're raising our hands, when we're releasing that in our brains as we worship the Lord together. When you come to worship service and when you leave, you should leave happier. If you don't, but that's one of the reasons that I'm teaching on these different seven different words for praise in the Hebrew words for praise in the Bible, is that I'm trying to help us go home happier when we leave than when we came. This is the place you should be able to lay your burdens down and leave them. So it literally is to make you feel better. It's releasing our brain, get us out of our depressive state. And the fun fact is, it's Amos. Sorry, I don't I've lost it. But the scripture says that when I went, I was not able to worship the Lord, but I went to the house of the Lord, and the house of the Lord lifted me up. You see, when you're depressed or when you're down, you need to run to church, not stay away from church. You need to run to church, and we need to make sure we're worshiping the Lord so that His presence is here, because the one that doesn't feel like it, that's been through a trauma, been through a pain, that can't worship Him, we will lift them up. We will create oxytocin in their brain, and all of a sudden this loss they had this week, this trauma they had this week, is a little less, because now there's something happening. The Spirit is moving. The Lord is working in our midst. And so now we're lifting Him up, and now we're lifting them up. That's the whole point. That's why David said, "Oh, let us magnify the Lord together, and let us exalt His name." Worship is good. One-on-one, that's good, but it is something very specific in Scripture that talks about this worship being a together thing. People in battle, they talk about warriors going to battle. I don't have time for that one. Do we have a rugby video, Brooklyn? Sort of. Well, we can either do it or not. I don't care. You want to try it? Make you want to go do something right there. They do these before, obviously they weren't dressed for that, but they do these before a rugby match to psych themselves up and to psych the other team out. They won. It worked. But they all were chanting together. There's power released when a team or a band or a crew of people cry out together, shouting together. And when we worship God together, it's not just, we all know those songs, it's not just fun, although it can be and it should be. And I want to encourage you in those in church, in those, I even wrote the word dancey. It's not even a word. I made up a word this week. In those dancey songs, to go ahead and, it's okay if your knees start to feel like, oh, what? This ain't never happened. This always just happened in the club. This ain't never happened in church before. My knees are bending for some reason. I feel like it's okay to let that happen, because actually God created dance. He created all of it. And it's okay for something to happen to your hands. It's okay for something to happen to your mouth. It's okay for something that you want to lift your hands, or your knees need to bend a little bit, or you even pick that, be careful, don't get too crazy, pick that foot up just a second there. You know, have you ever seen somebody that was really, really dancing and they were frowning? Not very often. Most of the time, they're laughing, and the fun fact is those that are watching are laughing too. Because it's a lighter thing. It's a thing of, you know what? It's a happier time. It is an expression of that. That's a different word. That's halal. We'll talk about it. But I want you to understand again what we're doing. The when we're praising together, it's contagious. First point of the roar of worship soothes an aching heart. Been in a room full of people. Go through a hard time, I mentioned that just a second ago, and you're struggling, and the worship of people around you bring us together, bring us up. When we come in, we don't just sing, we're lifting our hands, we're lifting our hearts, we're lifting our spirits, we're pushing, we're making sure that we press in, we make space, we press in to the presence of the Lord, and it's not just for us, it's for us. It is not just vertical worship. There is such thing as horizontal worship. It ought to affect those around you. 2 Chronicles 15, 14 and 15. Then they took an oath before the Lord with a loud voice, with shouting and trumpets and ram's horns. And all Judah rejoiced at the oath, for they had sworn with all their heart and sought him with their soul. And he was found by them, and the Lord gave them rest all around. The roar can bring rest. The roar of worship soothes our aching heart. Two, the roar of worship sinks our hearts with heaven. The roar of worship sinks our hearts with heaven. Psalm 145, I will praise your name forever and ever. And like I said earlier, that's our life. Worshiping God forever and ever. So we gather, when we gather as a church, as we roar in worship as a church, we're sinking our hearts with heaven. Revelation 5 and 11 says this, then I looked and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne, the living creatures and the elders. The number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. When we worship, we're sinking our hearts with heaven. We're sinking our hearts with heaven's worship. This roar of worship that we get to be a part of now is a little preview of what you're going to experience in heaven when we'll be surrounded by the angels and by the saints of old. When you happen to be standing there around the throne and David, King David, is dancing his little heart out and singing, I promise it's at least going to make you smile, if not make you want to dance too. Singing, worthy, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Imagine with me for just a minute, as you're worshiping Jesus, what we can't see, it's the connecting half that is heaven. And it's just bringing you closer. And so when the things of this world are weighing you down, you're struggling, when you're hurting, when there's tension in your heart, in your life, relationships, worship is an easy way to remind you that, yes, I'm on this side, but soon and very soon, I will be on that side. And right now, we're worshiping our Savior with the angels and the saints with a separation. But there will come a day when that separation will be torn down and we will be there with them around the throne worshiping Jesus. Three, the roar of worship sends us into battle. Joshua 6 and 20. So the people shouted when the priest blew the trumpet. And it happened when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat. There are many examples in the Bible of battle scenes, as they were just, that we saw in that rugby pregame. There was guys that were yelling and doing their thing, and everybody else was like, yeah, let's go, let's go. Do we have any of the other ones that we tried to get there, Brooklyn? Let's see what this is here. I got my overlay on. Another one? All right. So that's how many of y'all remember William Wallace when he that one, I was trying to get that one up there and I didn't get to do it in time. But so I want to do this for just a minute. I want to take a moment and thank our worship team and our worship leaders for the fact that they're really sending us into battle. There is really a battle cry of worship, and I want to thank them. They lead us into the throne room of God. So when I say battle, what are you talking about? The scripture, Ephesians, actually says we are in a battle, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but we do wrestle against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. So we're meant to stand. We're meant to move forward. We're meant to enter the battle. Every day. Our battle is not with your battle is not with your spouse. Your battle is not with your children. The battle is not flesh and blood. Your battle is not with your coworker that drives you bonkers. The battle is flesh and blood. Your battle is not with your boss who drives you bonkers. Your battle's not flesh and blood. We are sent out to where God has called us to. We're sent out to the lives He's called us to live. We're sent out to contend. We're sent out to love. We're sent out to give. And the roar of worship sends us into battle. The roar of worship spreads hope to a hurting and hopeless world. Every Christmas the last 2 years, I've preached a message on the Christmas table. It's one of my favorite messages to preach. I love preaching that message. And I preached it actually the year before that at Legacy. I've preached it, so I got preached it for the last 3 years on Christmas, of the Christmas table. We have people that come to us that are hurting. There are people that come that aren't saved. They come here, they're hurting. They are saved, and they're hurting. But why? Because we have a table that the Lord has let us spread and put out. Everyone is invited to the table. Look at your neighbor and say, you're invited to the table. Look at your neighbor and say, there's more invited to the table. Bring more, bring more, bring more. There's a bigger table. There's more room at the table. How much fun is it when the table's full and all of a sudden you got to bring another chair? Ain't that fun? I mean, it is. It's like, oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. Yeah, yeah. I didn't know y'all were coming tonight. Come on over here, sit with us. The waiter doesn't like it, but we love it. Hey, can you just pass this over? You know, you got to hope the fire marshal doesn't come in because we're in trouble. You see, in the church, they ought to come in and they ought to see us worshiping, and then they ought to feel us worshiping and the presence of the Lord moving in the place, and they're able to be touched because worship touches a hurting and aching world. They might not understand even what's happening. They don't need to, because they can feel it. Psalm 101, make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you lands. Isaiah 12, praise the Lord, which is Yada. Call upon his name. Declare his deeds among the people. Make mention that his name is exalted. Sing to the Lord, for he has done excellent things. This is known in all the earth. Cry out and shout, O inhabitant of Zion, for great is the Lord of Israel in your midst. We cry out to tell the whole world where we are, as we worship God, the world sees. Number five, the roar of worship strengthens the next generation. I showed you two Sundays ago a picture of my son leading worship, playing in a band, leading worship a couple weeks ago. Wasn't even playing, just had his hands in the air. I'm not doing this about me. I'm just trying to help you understand something. Do you know where he saw that first? He's about 4 minutes old. He's about 5 days old. He comes to church. Barely got his eyes open, but he saw people with their hands in the air. He saw people clapping. He heard people singing. Today, we'd put earmuffs on him. I don't care. It's fine. But it's like, you know, and it's good. I mean, our grandbabies had ear headphones on at church. That's okay. But where do you learn this? We learn it from the generation before. I was actually confronted by someone, this is many years ago, I was confronted by someone because I'd just come home from evangelizing, I was preaching, had a revival, it was two nights long and it lasted 3 weeks, God was really moving, and I come home and my pastor had me come up and say something, and man, I was yelling and wiping my head, and we was going after it, and so I got confronted after service. Someone came to me and said, I want you to know something, young man, it's not all in the jump and shout. I said, yes, ma'am, I agree with you, but it ain't all in the sitting on a pew and acting like a stump on a log either. That did not go over well. Just saying, don't try that one. It didn't go over well. But I'm telling you this, is that you can pass what? The next generation is watching you, and if you come to church and are mean all the time, why do you think they're going to want what you have? If church doesn't change you and make you love like Jesus loves, you want to whack everybody with your cane because you're in pain. Here's my thing. I say this, so I've been trying to change and change and change and change hard, because I believe that when we're older, we don't get mean. I've seen people that got old and they got mean. And I don't think that's what happened. I believe that when we get older, we care less and the fluff is gone. And so just who we are comes out. So I've been asking Jesus, please change me before I get to that point, because I've been mean a lot in my life. And I don't want that to be my normal. So I'm not pointing fingers at all. They all pointing at me. I don't want to do that. Because worship strengthens the next generation. I want to raise worshipers. And I got two more back there in the nursery. We're going to put a few more back there in the nursery before long. Whatever, I'm not prophesying. That's faith. But I want to raise worshipers. And I wanted to teach them to be able to be strengthened because they understand what worship is all about. Let's go. 6. The roar of worship scares the enemy. I got two things to tell you about this. This is fun. The American Indian would give a war cry. Y'all remember that? The American Indian would give a war cry. They asked them, why do you do that? They said, well, two things. One reason that we give the war cry is it lets everyone know whose team we're on. Because everybody's yelling the same thing as they go to fight. And the other one is, it just scares the enemy slap crazy. These people are crazy. They're crazy, you know. The roar of worship scares the enemy because they realize we're united and we're all in this together. You're not fighting this one by yourself. See, that was the whole problem with Goliath and David. Goliath kept looking over at Saul and the children in the army of Israel and said, hey, send me a man. It's never been about one man in God's army. It's never been about one man in God's army. It's always been about the team. It's always been about the whole army. Hey, I don't know if I got anybody over here that can whoop that dude, but there's about 50 of us that we might, 49 of us might die, but he's going to die because we're going to go get him. We're going to take him out. How come nobody looked around and said, hey, why don't about 6 of my best friends, why don't we go over there and let's just whoop this dude? I'm tired of listening to him. Oh, he's big, I know, but somebody's going to have to kick him in his knees. He might get a shot in on a couple of us. You see, that's fighting on the enemy's terms. The enemy's trying to separate you from the family of God. The enemy doesn't want unity. I heard this week that there was a church that split over the color of carpet that they picked. I don't doubt it a bit. That's how silly stuff is sometimes. When it really gets down to it, to the kingdom of God and heaven and earth and heaven and hell, when it really, we divide over the dumbest stuff. Who cares what color the carpet is? Well, I do. Sure we do. But not enough to leave the church. What hurts my eyes? Stop. It's not worth heaven and hell. I'm just going to show my family that when I don't get my way, I'm leaving. That you're right. You're teaching them something right there. That was a good word. 7, last one. The roar of worship sets God in his right place in our hearts and on the throne. Started with this verse, Psalm 47, 1 and 2. Oh, clap your... Oh, I didn't either. This is a good one. Oh, clap your hands, all you people. Shout to God with a voice of triumph. For the Lord Most High is awesome. He is a great king over all the earth. We shout because God is worthy. We give him our everything because he's worthy. Shabbat. What is it good for? Absolutely everything. Because God is our absolute everything. He's good. He's so good. And that's the kind of shout that will soothe our soul. And that'll bring healing balm to the world. Amen. 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 Let's stand. We're going to close with that. We just bow our heads for just a minute. Father, I thank you. Thank you for the power of praise. Thank you for expanding our understanding and teaching us about what praise is good for, and what you are doing in our lives, in the church, those around us, and in the world. And Lord, I just ask that today, as you're teaching us, as you're showing us, as you're walking with us, I pray that you would just stretch our hearts, stretch our understanding, stretch our comfort zone, Lord, for more of you. We make space for you, not just every time we come to church, but every time we wake up, we put our feet on the floor, that we make space for you. When we go to bed, we make space for you, Lord, that even in the nighttime, even no matter what it is, we give space for you to work and to move in our lives. Lord, I want to be a worshiper. Yeah, I want to be a good preacher. I want to be a good pastor. But Lord, more than that, when this is all said and done, I want it to be said of me that no matter what was going on in his life, he still had a praise for God. The one time in my life I want to be like Pilate, I find no fault with him. God, I've had a lot of problems in my life. You've never been one of them. You've never been a problem. And I want to be a praiser. I want to be a worshiper of you. Not just with my mouth, but with my actions, God, of what I do. I feel like changing it up just a little bit this morning, if you'll just give me that grace. While your heads are bowed, I feel like I know I prayed my heart, but I kind of feel like I prayed the Father's heart right there for just a minute, that we would all just be worshipers no matter what else is going on in our lives. If that's where you are, I just want to be a worshiper. I just want to praise. I want, when it's all said and done, nothing else matters, I want to make sure I've given God praise. Would you just slip your hand up? Amen. Thank you. Amen. Thank you. Just put them back down when you put them up. Thank you. Amen. I want to be a worshiper. I want to be a worshiper. And so today, as we say that together, as we take just a minute, as we sing, I just want you to, God, whatever's in my heart, whatever needs to change, I just pray you would change it. Because God, I want to be a worshiper. I want to be a praiser of you.
Space. just today want to share our hearts with you. Thank you today that you were here to worship with us. This week, there has been a lot of answered prayer, like even within my own family. Hope this morning came just to thank the Lord for the healing that we have seen in little Gunner. Earlier this week, he was simply fighting to breathe. And a lot of you were lifting up in to the Lord, like on his behalf. Aid in prayer for the healing. And we thank you for that. I thank you for that as a grandfather. I'm so thankful that I am a part of this special family of faith. That we don't walk alone, that we walk together. But as we close this morning, and I listened to the sermon this morning, I couldn't help but think of a quote from Saint quote that says, always preach the gospel, and when necessary, use words. May we have Shabbat this week on our faces, also on our hands, in how we help others. If we never say a word, let us live loud, let us live large for the Lord in this week. Let's pray. God, you've heard our worship today. You've heard the message today, that we would live a life of worship to you in all that we do. Sunday mornings shouldn't be that anything that we're not doing all other 6 days. And Father, as we leave here today, may we live large for you. May we live loud in our actions, in our attitudes, in our smiles, in our hugs, in all that we do. I pray this in the name of Jesus. This morning, as we close, let's leave with a roar. But praise the Lord. Say it with me. Praise the Lord. Come on. Let's say it loud with a roar.
Praise the Lord.
Somebody else say it loud with a roar. Go and serve him. You are dismissed.